born in New York City, Flower and Fifth Hospital in Manhattan. Well, I had mother and father. I had a sister who I didn't know really well. She was retarded and was at a institution upstate. So I, for all practical purposes, was an only child. My father, he was an immigrant from Italy, came over to this country in, when he was 14 years old. Worked in hotels and restaurants, and I think got paid the princely sum of, he came over in 1908, I think. He was paid the princely sum of $5 a week or something like that, and on that he was able to pay his room and board and send money back so his brothers could come over. My mother, who he met up at a hotel in Canada, was a French-Canadian. So my father became a citizen by joining the U.S. Army for World War I. Anyway.
Okay. And so your hometown's New York?
Well, I graduated from high school when I was 16. Newtown High School, the only notable graduate from there was Don Rickles, if you remember Don Rickles. I graduated at 16 and I went out to the University of Colorado. And after my second year, I became a resident of Colorado. I was major. I got a degree from the University of Colorado in Asian Studies, so I knew a bit more about the politics and so on of the area and so on. So probably gave me a different view of it. I was young and. At the same time I went to Colorado, I joined the Navy ROTC, so I knew I was going to go into the service, and in fact, I volunteered to go to Vietnam. First ship that I was assigned to was amphibious troop transport, and in 1965, we took the 3rd Marines to a place called Chu Lai. I was in Vietnam because I went with them on the boat to make sure we got our life jackets back and touched the sand, so I could say I was actually there, but we were there for about 4 hours. About a year or so later, I went for a one-year tour on board the ARG-4, the USS Tutuila. It was the Navy's last internal combustion engine repair ship, and it was in a place called Vung Tau. It's in the mouth of the Mekong Delta, and we were like a pit stop for riverine boats and swift boats and things like that. Well, first time I was there, the impression was very nice beach. It's probably a resort now. One thing they have a long coastline and a lot of white sandy beaches. The second time I was there on the transport where we spent the year there, we were anchored in a place called Vung Tau. And Vung Tau was an in-country R&R. In other words, after you were in country for a certain period of time, service people could go to different places for rest and recreation. I went to Australia, some went to Hawaii, you know, different places. But for in-country, where it was a short whatever, they had this place right there in Vung Tau. And it was pretty peaceful. There was not much going on in Vung Tau. We always assumed that the Viet Cong were collecting taxes from the bars and things, and so they weren't going to disrupt their income source. Well, it's like anything else. Many of them were agricultural type folks. You know, they weren't just trying to get by. There were a lot that had advanced educations. Many of them spoke French from the good old days. But we didn't have a whole lot of interaction with them. It wasn't you know, we sort of just did our job and whatever. Well, daily routine, I was a deck officer. And as I say, we were like a pit stop. We would have boats, a lot of patrol boats, and they would always be running over Vietnamese fishing nets and running into one thing and another. So they'd come alongside us, again, with a repair ship. We'd pick them up out of the water. We'd push a pontoon. It was a rather large pontoon, maybe 40 feet. Set them down on a, set the boat down on skids, push them back over. Then the repair guys would go over sort of like ants or pit crew. You know, they'd go down there, and frequently it was the screws or the shaft that had to be removed, and they'd slap new ones in and take care of it, and then pick them up, put them back in the water. And we got it down to about an hour per stop. So. But the daily routine, and then on top of that, we had to, as an officer, you had to stand watches you know, regular watches. We only got underway. Repair ships aren't doing their work if they're moving, so we didn't move a lot. But a couple times, one time we went over to a place called An Thoi, which was just a fill-in for a ship that had to go get repairs. And An Thoi was interesting. It had two things. One was a Vietnamese prisoner of war camp, and the second was a Nook Mom factory. Now, I don't know if you've heard of Nook Mom, but Nook Mom is a rather sweet, nice, whatever, tasting oil. It's like soy sauce, but it's the Vietnamese version. It looks like oil more. But they fermented, and they fermented with rotting fish heads and things. And you don't want to be downwind of a Nook Mom factory, which we frequently were because we were right off the, you know, whatever. I do remember one time we had a beach party, and again, beautiful sandy beach, and we were playing volleyball and having a few drinks, and this. The water was just as clear as crystal. And I got out a fair distance when it dawned on me that the only one of the few places in the world where they have venomous snakes, water snakes, was Vietnam. And you don't survive their bite because they're not neurotoxin like a rattlesnake go to the blood system. They're a neurotoxin. They go after the nervous system. Anyway, so I beat a hasty retreat. I didn't see any snakes, fortunately. So. But that was about it. We had one sailor who was, you know, sort of sitting on the bow of the ship, and a sniper hit him in the, by sure chance, must have fired it from miles away, in the knee. And other than that, the only casualty we had, I was not on the ship, I was away at the time, but the ship's doctor, who also was from Boulder, Colorado, upstream from us was a place called Cat Low. Cat Low was a Coast Guard base, U.S. Coast Guard, but it had Vietnamese and it had Navy, patrol boats and so on. And it was the only place when they had the town was off limits because of Tet or one thing and another. They'd take a bunch of sailors there, and needless to say that they tended to get a little drunk. One of them fell off into the water and almost drowned, so they were rushing him to a hospital in town. And they were racing along. They had these things called jeepneys. Jeepneys are a sort of a motorcycle with a thing in the back where five or six people could actually sit. Any rate, it came around the corner and the ambulance missed them. Hit a tree and a wall, and killed the driver immediately. Everybody that was in the back of the ambulance got thrown out the back, and the doctor who had gone along with them, he was killed, and I think another guy was killed. And the only person to survive it all was the drunk sailor. He, I guess, felt no pain. So, but that was our only casualty. We were, we were not. Getting attacked on any kind of basis. Well, I had a number of different things. You know, junior officers, again, I was an ensign and then became a lieutenant JG. They give you all sorts of what they call collateral duties. So my main duty, of course, was the deck officer, taking care of deck operations and what have you. Then beyond that, I was the gunnery officer, which was kind of humorous because the biggest gun we had was a 3-inch World War II type, you know, gun. They used to have four of them, but the one on the stern was removed so they could put a helicopter pad back there. And then the collateral duties, narcotics control officer, duty, you know, guys were shipping stuff home, I was responsible for that. Welfare and rec officer. In fact, in that particular role, I was able to find the NAV4V, I think it was the naval commander for the whole area. They had 40 Christmas trees and 40 boxes of decorations for us, for the area, not just for our ship, but all the Navy facilities down there. So I had to go up, find a way to get up there, and then bring them back. Well, I got a helicopter ride up to Saigon to pick them up, and I got all my stuff, and now there's a question, how am I going to get them back? And I was talking to the sergeant who was at the air base, and he was not, you know, particularly interested in my problem of getting all these boxes back. But finally, I told him how nice a tree and decorations would look in his office. I figured a sacrifice of one each was worth it. And so he agreed to let me get on one of this. It was an Otter. It's a small single-engine plane that the Army had. And at first the pilot was a little, but I showed him how light they were. There was really no weight. So we loaded them all on there, and I got them back down to Vung Tau and the area, and we got them distributed to all, whatever. So one of the more harrowing experiences. I mean, most of it had to do with the, you know, beach and so on. I'm not a beer drinker, and about the only thing they, you know, the ships sometimes would have beer parties on the float, which so it technically wasn't on the ship. There's no drinking allowed on a ship. I remember one time, again in my role as welfare and rec, we had a beach party on one of the beaches, and I asked one of the sailors to go back and bring me some diesel fuel to put on the fire, you know, it was like fire starter. Unfortunately, he brought back gasoline, and I didn't have any eyebrows for a while, but there was a couple things. One, we did medvacs, which is, and all, I think, U.S. units did this sort of thing if they had doctors, and we had a doctor and a dentist on board ship, so I went along with them as the gunnery officer. I had a 45 on my belt. That was the biggest thing, and I actually never took it out of the plastic wrap because if I took it out of the plastic, I'd have to clean the weapon, so I left it in the plastic. But we had some, I think we had some Marines with us or whatever, and we went up the middle of nowhere, some village, to provide medical and dental assistance to them. But there was a couple combat missions, if you will, one that sort of came upon us. I was with a boatload of sailors. We were up to Catlow where they had a, you know, drink, they could drink, and, you know, they had other volleyball and things like that. And it was during Tet. And as nightfall was coming, word went up that there was firing in the town. It turns out later it was fireworks and so on, but they assumed it was firing in the town. And so they immediately alerted the people at Catlow, and they armed all our drunk sailors. There was like a trench, L-shaped type trench, and they were manning this trench. And I think it was the chaplain and I went in. We were sort of watching it with our eyeballs. We were watching all this going on, and we could see flares off in the distance and so on. And They had swift boats with 50 caliber, that machine guns. They were sorting out in the harbor of Catlo. And the back at our ship, an Australian destroyer, an American destroyer who had been in Australia, and whose sailors were the ones primarily that were at Catlo that I was, you know, escorting, kept bugging our CO if he could provide gunfire support. Well, of course, there was no shooting going on. So finally, the destroyer captain was, in fact, a four-stripe captain, whereas the CO of our ship was a commander, three-stripe. So a three-stripe can say no to a four-stripe just so often. And so finally, he agreed to have him fire a what they call a star shell. And it would go overhead and light everything up. Well, now, they were 5 miles away, keep in mind. He fired this star shell from his destroyer, and it went off right above where all the swift boats were. So had there been an actual enemy out there, whatever, they would have lit them up like a Christmas tree. But then the actual casing from the star shell splashed in the water, and someone yelled, "Recoilless rifle round." Well, it wasn't. It was just a shell. But so they opened fire in their area, you know, free fire zone. It was an Army artillery base about 5 kilometers from us. Hearing the Navy base opening up, started firing in their free fire zone with their artillery. Another 5 kilometers over was an Australian artillery base. Hearing the American artillery going, they started with theirs. Well, we had a full-fledged battle going on with flares and shooting and whatever. It was missing only one element, and that was the enemy. They were nowhere to be, you know, nowhere in the area. We were just shooting for the heck of it, so. Well, parents, basically, but that was about it. I mean, I didn't have a lot of friends from New York because I left when I was pretty young to go off to college. And most of the friends I had in college were, in fact, I remember one night, or one day, when I was getting ready to go to R&R in Australia, they would send you to a place called Camp Alpha at Tonsonut Air Force Base. It was a transit type camp. And you get there one day and the next morning plane would, you know, take off to wherever. And we're sitting there and they started to get shelled. And rockets and mortars and things like that. And so the sergeant came running through and he said, "Get on the deck and cover yourself with the mattress." So he did that. And the mattresses were like this, you know, it was not much bigger than a good comforter, you know. And it dawned on me that all this was going to do was sop up the blood if I actually got hit with something. It wasn't going to help protect me. So I got up and walked over to the officers' club. I'd been there earlier, but it was pretty quiet. And on the way towards it, I discovered all these Quonset huts, all the windows had been blown out from some shells. And I figured if it had been 15 minutes either way, I probably would have, you know, got hit. But I spent the day there, and several friends from college were also there. One was in the Air Force, and the other one was in the Army. So we had, you know, had a few drinks. And that night, I was getting ready to go back to Camp Alpha. And they say, you can spend the night here. We have mattresses we put on the tables. I said, sure, you know. And their mattresses were that thick. So the next morning I got up and was shaving. And we had all these Air Force Reserve people would come in on the weekends, fly in with stuff, and then fly out. And I was sitting there at the table eating my scrambled eggs and what have you. And we started getting this whomp, whomp, you know, the rocket attack again. And they all got up by the walls, and I just kept eating. I figured, you know, we got to do, you know, walls going to help. And then it dawned on me, it's probably not a good idea for Navy Lieutenant JG to be, you know, showing up these colonels and things. So I took my breakfast and ate it over there. Well, you know, when you're young, you don't think about that stuff too much, I guess. You know, I mean, I actually considered staying an extra 6 months so I could get a free month's, you know, travel. But the I remember I was on when I was in Australia on R&R. It was at this beach bar or something, and they had some guy who was a radio announcer from Chicago calling, wanting to talk to some. And apparently there were demonstrations going on in Chicago, anti-war stuff. And the guy asked me, you know, what do you think about that? And I said, well, I mean, it's, you know, free speech. If they want to demonstrate, let them demonstrate. And he was upset with that because he thought, you know, I should be, you know. You know, I mean, the war was what it was. I mean, we were doing our job. We were taking care of, you know, issues and so on. When I got back, that's when I became upset. When I saw people, like certain news people who were, you know, talking about this, and I looked at the TV and I said, that's not going on. It's not real, they're making it up. And it turns out they were making it up. They were deliberately setting fires to villages just to create whatever. But at that time, I stopped, this is 1967 or so, I stopped watching network news and never did watch it after that. So I didn't experience any of the, you know, returning home type stuff that a lot of veterans did, as far as people spitting at them or whatever. I don't know, maybe it's because of where we came in. I seem to remember we came into San Francisco. And I went to get my car. I had friends who lived in Oakland, of all places. I had just gotten a Mercedes-Benz, a diesel, and I let them keep it for the year while I was in Vietnam. And the wife managed to let the oil run out, and it blew up my engine, so I was greeted with a $1,000 bill to fix my car. And anyway, so I drove back to Boulder, and I worked at a place in Boulder called The Sink. It was a beer joint. Now, and the reason I got hired, I think, was because I admitted to the owner I didn't like to drink beer. The minute I said that, he said, you're hired. That paid for my salary alone. You know, back then, $1.25 an hour was a good deal, you know. At any rate, I went back there, and I did hear some mutterings, you know, just Boulder, Colorado, if you think about it, 67, when I walked in my uniform, and I went in the back, changed my clothes into what I used to wear at The Sink, which was a cutoff, whatever, old jeans and so on, and went over to the table that was making noise and said, you have something to say? You know, at that time I was a big guy, you know, I was a bouncer, and they had nothing to say, so that was it. Well, I think it's like anything else. One of my, again, better friends was the doctor, because he was from Boulder, Colorado, who got killed. It's a funny thing. There are your reunion groups later on and so on. But usually after, you know, you've done your service and whatever, you tend to lose track of them. You know. Not that I know of, but because you're always the last to know. I remember the time I was in Annapolis, and I saw a headline in the Capital newspaper. It was talking about post-traumatic syndrome, and I said, well, I don't have any post-traumatic. I said, and this is a joke, I would say, and then I kicked the paper box, but I didn't kick it. But I probably had some, you know, things, especially after that, when I started watching TV and saw those, you know, reports. But other than that, no, not really. Well, I guess, you know, we knew or should have known going into the war that the people we were getting ready to fight were advocates of protracted warfare. By that I mean they don't expect to win, you know, the first month, the first year. They just wear you down. And as Americans, we tend to like quick resolution. We're not very patient. I'm surprised to the extent that we're still involved in the Mideast in some ways. we just don't do well in those long, whatever. I mean, we're still in Korea, but we're not fighting, you know, all the time. And I think the lesson probably should be that what we need to do is to have a quick response, quick reaction, go do it. And if we have to go back and do it again every so often, so be it. But it's better than just letting it drag on and on and on. You know, in World War II, the Marines and the Army had different philosophies of capturing islands, Japanese-held islands. The Army always had the mentality of moving forward and making sure there was no opposition behind you. You know, if there's a pocket of resistance, everything stops while you make sure you take care of that. The Marines, on the other hand, established what the, you know, the goal was, the other end of the island, the top, the mountain, whatever. And this went hell-bent for leather and left pockets behind and then went back and whatever. They took a lot of casualties that way, but they took a lot of casualties for one day. The Army, on the other hand, would take fewer casualties on a day, but would take a week or more, and each day when you finally piled up, they had taken more casualties, but it didn't seem as bad. I think that's what we have to learn, is if there's an issue, we've got to go take care of it and get ourselves out of there and not make it all-consuming. And then realize that nothing lasts forever and we may have to go back and do it again. That's at least my impression. Again, I don't think we've learned that lesson, unfortunately. And maybe it's because, you know, political leaders don't want to have a headline.
Well, it's probably two different things. I mean, I... you know, I was... didn't think about it that much. I mean, at the time, I was just doing my duty, you know, doing what I was, you know, I volunteered to go. I got to go, got to come back. The generation, hard to say. I mean, a lot of people saw things, you know, differently. It's the old joke about the blind guys and the elephant. You know, they all feel different parts of the elephant. They all think it's something else. So I, but... it was, I think it was in some ways disappointing. I mean, we had, it was a kind of war where up to this point, even now, I mean, you look at people generally, you know, they may not like the war, but they're always gung-ho for the, you know, for the service people and so on, so they claim. And that was not the case at that time, so.
And accept it that soon you'll be drenched to the bone. And if your breath to you is worth saving, then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone. For the times, they are a-changing. Come writers and critics who prophesize with your pen, and keep your eyes wide, the chance won't come again. And don't speak too soon, for the wheel's still in spin, and there's no telling who that it's naming. For the loser now will be later to win, 'cause the times, they are a-changing. Senators, congressmen, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't block up the hall. For he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. 'Cause the battle outside raging will soon shake your windows and rattle your walls. For the times, they are a-changing. Mothers and fathers throughout the land, and don't criticize what you can't understand. Your sons and your daughters are beyond your command. Your old road's rapidly aging. please get out of the new one if you can't lend your hand, 'cause the times, they are a-changing. The line, it is drawn, the curse, it is cast, the slowest now will later be fast, as the present now will later be past. The order is rapidly fading, and the first one now will later be last, 'cause the time